for Q4 and annual results of FY21 conference call. We are pleased to have this opportunity to update our progress and answer your questions. We hope everyone and their family members, colleagues, and friends are safe during this severe second wave of COVID pandemic.
The conference is now being recorded.
The status of our locations. Our manufacturing units, R&D center, corporate office, all function normally during the FY21. At Laurus, we are committed to protecting the health and well-being of our employees and their families. We continue to implement rigorous safety and hygiene measures across all locations without any complacency. I'm extremely proud of the agility and resilience of our teams have shown in the face of this challenge since last year. I'm very thankful to all our colleagues for rising to this challenge and ensuring business continuity. Our performance focus is on growth driven by excellent execution and creating a platform for our future growth with manufacturing capacity expansions, a combination of brownfield as well as greenfield in API formulations as well as our custom synthesis divisions. In FY21, we have established a wholly-owned subsidiary, Laurus Synthesis Private Limited, to take care of contract manufacturing for big pharma, and also it incorporated another step-down subsidiary named Laurus Ingredients Private Limited. These initiatives will bring focus to our contract manufacturing division to allocate, create, offer increased capacity to service customer needs. We believe by the end of FY23, this division, Laurus Synthesis, will be self-reliant in all respects. We have forayed into biotechnology space by acquiring a majority stake in Richcore Life Sciences Private Limited, which was renamed as Laurus Bio. The current promoters will continue to run the operations, and this acquisition gives us entry into fermentation capabilities as well as foray into recombinant proteins. In the medium term, what we expect this division to be vertically integrated into offering a contract development and manufacturing services in biotech space. We're happy to share that FY21, Laurus Labs has done exceptionally well. Our Q4 revenues stood at 1,412 crores, showcasing a robust growth of 68% year-on-year. And for the whole year, we have achieved 4,813 crores revenue with a growth of 70%. To begin with, we would like to share the key updates on our various segments. In the formulation division, we achieved 1,664 crores, and in the current quarter, we have done 430 crores revenue. The revenue contribution from the formulation division for the whole year is about 38%. Recently, we also got an approval for a triple combination antiretroviral drug containing tenofovir alafenamide. We are in the process of obtaining in-country registrations. We already got orders for this triple drug combination, and we expect to service those orders in the first half of FY22. Apart from LMIC business, we have also seen growth in developed markets in North America as well as in Europe. To leverage our front-end U.S. business, we have commenced the marketing of in-licensed products. Out of five in-licensed products, two products were launched, and we are in the process of launching the rest of the products in the next 6 months. We have a total of nine final approvals and eight tentative approvals out of the 26 ANDAs filed so far. In Canada, we have eight approvals and four launched, and two more products will be launched soon. For EU, we have validated additional products as part of the contract manufacturing with our partner, and we expect significant upside from these products in FY23. We also obtained approvals and marketing authorizations for 5 products, 2 of those launched, and we are in the process of launching others shortly. As we informed, we continue to invest in strengthening and enhancing our formulation infrastructure. Capacity expansion through debottlenecking was operational and already commercially used right now. Our brownfield expansion on the same site will, with similar capacities, will become operational in a phased manner from October 2021 and will be fully operational by end of FY22. On the R&D front, we continue to invest about 4% of our revenue. And in the generic API division, this year was very good for our antiretroviral APIs. We have achieved 1850 crore API sale in antiretroviral. This was the highest ARV API sale so far. And second line ARV APIs also continue to see healthy sales in Q4. Due to the increase in the demand for third party API sales, we are still expanding the API capacity to serve the existing demand from the customers. We expect to maintain good sales for ARV APIs in FY22 as well. In the oncology segment, we recorded a 5% growth in the current quarter over Q3. As you are aware, Laurus Labs has one of the largest high-potent API capacity in the country, and we are expanding high-potent API manufacturing capabilities in one of our Unit 4 at Achyutapuram. We expect oncology business to grow fairly well in the coming quarters as well. The most important piece of contract manufacturing of generic APIs and non-ARV, non-oncology, we have seen a healthy growth in Q4, and we have initiated validation of several APIs, non-ARV, non-oncology, and we are adding additional manufacturing capacities for these products. So our diversification efforts in generic APIs will be very visible in FY23 as these capacities come commercially utilized. And in the synthesis division, we recorded a growth of almost 20% from Q4 FY22 to Q4 FY21. We have achieved a sales growth of over 35% when compared to FY20 to FY21. We are pursuing several active projects in the late stage clinical programs, as well as the commercial supplies of 4 products which are ongoing. Construction activity is in progress at the dedicated CRAMS R&D at Genome Valley, Hyderabad. We have also acquired land for new manufacturing site, a greenfield at Vizag, which will cater to the manufacturing needs of this division for the next 4 to 5 years. We are also in the process of acquiring an additional land for this division to manufacture steroids and hormones, high-potent molecules. That land will be at Parawada, very close to our existing manufacturing facilities. When it comes to Laurus Bio, we have closed the transaction to acquire majority stake in Richcore in the month of January. And Laurus Bio is on the course of commissioning a large-scale fermentation capability, 180,000 liters, in the next 2 weeks. We are also planning to acquire additional land for further expansion of our Laurus Bio by creating close to 1 million liters fermentation capacity. With that, I would like to hand it over to Ravi to share the financial highlights.
Thank you, Dr. Satya, and very warm welcome to everyone. I wish and pray God that everyone is safe at your home and your offices. Let me quickly take through some of the highlights. Income from operation for the quarter is at 1413 crores, and it's a 68% growth. For the full year, we did about 4814 crore with a growth of 70%. With a better product mix, gross margin improved significantly. Now at 55% gross margin, our EBITDA is one of the best achieved so far, is 34% for the quarter four. Our diluted EPS for the quarter without annualization is 5.5 rupees, whereas our annual EPS for the full year is 18 rupees 30 paisa. Our ROCE is 40% on annualized basis due to operational leverage and higher asset utilization. On a capex front, we have incurred around 700 crores, which includes the capital work in progress. Out of this capex, we have invested 50% into the APIs, around 30% into the FDF, and 20% for a contract manufacturing and bio. So the 20%, probably 10% each for bio and synthesis. And we are way forward in the coming periods also. We will be spending in the similar ratios. And what we are expecting, capex in the next 2 years will be 1500 to 1700 crore for the 2 years. So why we are giving a 2 year guidance is there will be spillovers from 1 year to the other. We have incorporated an step-down subsidiary for our LoRa synthesis. Probably in the next 2 years' time, we are targeting to have an independent synthesis company. So where it has its own production, R&D, and business development. Of course, business development is separate already. So it will be in very independent business unit. We want to have an integrated player as we were, and that is the reason we are investing into the backward integration. We are investing into the intermediates and APIs. That is the reason 50% of the capex is getting into the API side. So we acquired a second site for our formulations in Hyderabad already. We have not yet started the activities, but we will start in the coming year. So based on the performance of the company, we have declared an third interim dividend of rupees 80 paisa per share. So with this, all three interim dividends together, it's coming to 2 rupees. It's like a 100% dividend. First time your company is being offered. With this, I would request the moderator to open the lines for Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Dhaval Shah from Girik Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello. Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah, good morning.
Yeah, good morning, team. Yes, it's a couple of questions from my side. So firstly, on the capex, just want to clarify, you mentioned 15 to 1700 crore over FY 22 and 23. Am I correct?
You are right. That's the plan as of now, to invest an additional 1500 crores in FY23 and FY23 put together.
Yeah, 22-23 put together. Correct. So is this, so from the last two con calls, what we have mentioned, is there an increase in the amount?
We have increased the capex for a based on the visibility what we have in the API division as well as formulation division based on the estimated approvals. And also, we are also investing significantly into custom synthesis based on certain projects we need to execute at a new manufacturing site depending on the volumes. So we have increased CapEx by around 500 crores than what we have indicated earlier. That increase is based on the visibility what we have right now from the customers and projects what we are handling.
Yes, yes. It was around 1,100 crore before. Yeah, correct.
Yeah.
It's partly added from the bio also.
Okay, bio, how much you will be allocating?
Bio this year around 60 crores.
Mm-hmm. Okay. 22 will be 60 crores. Okay. Okay, but majority is coming from API, the new
majority. I would say if we want to put an order of investment, the majority will go to API and then next to our CRAMS division and then formulations.
Got it. Sir, the question on the segmental numbers. Now, formulation we did around 430 crore. I believe there was some debottlenecking done. So, is the impact yet to be seen in the number because we are flat quarter on quarter?
We debottlenecking operation was completed in the month of March and the qualifications were done. That came into commercial use only in the current month, April. So that will be used in the first two quarters. And from quarter three onwards, we do expect a significant increase in our formulation capacity because we will be using the very large scale new building by October.
Okay, okay. And sir, on the under the API and the others category, you've seen a big traction, like 166 crore quarterly run rate now. So, any one-off in this, or how should we look at this number?
When it comes to the other APIs, it consists of contract manufacturing of generic APIs to other generic customers. So, this segment you have to see as a whole year rather than quarter to quarter. This year, FY22 and FY23, most of our CAPEX in API division is for non-ARV, non-oncology. So, non-ARV APIs will see significant sales increase partly in FY22, but big jump will come in FY23.
Okay, so you mean like we did around 500 crores in the other category for FY21. Now this number should significantly increase in 22 and more in 23.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, okay. And sir, there's a recent this today article in newspaper that China has reduced or stopped the cargo planes to India. Now, how is the impact you read for the pharmaceutical company, you know, in the current time when you have to meet, you know, demand, a lot of like pandemic-led demand also, plus exports, our exports demand. So, is there a big impact on us? Still, we depend a lot on China for KSM, couple of intermediaries, APIs.
We do depend on China for our starting materials, which generally we get through sea shipments. If it is an intermediate, people do get by air, but most of our shipments come by sea. We haven't seen any impact of the logistics challenges. The one thing is logistics costs have gone up in the recent past. Other than that, we haven't seen any disruption which is going to affect our manufacturing in the near future.
Okay, sir. Okay, okay. Got it, sir. Thank you very much. I'll come back in the queue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please limit your questions to two per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, would request you to rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Sudarshan Padmanabhan from Sundaram Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my questions and congrats on great set of numbers. Sir, my question is to, you know, understand this, you know, investment that you're doing in non-ARV, both, you know, with the FDF and the non-FDF coming together, you have given fair amount of, you know, threadbare discussion on the CDMO CRAMS business. And I understand that, you know, we are looking at almost 50 active projects and 4 projects almost at commercial level. We are also developing fair amount of strengths in hypo as well as chiral chemistry. So from the current level of, say, 500, 600 crores, say in the next 2 to 3 years, where do we see this business? And also from a longer term perspective, how do we see this, you know, business, you know, spanning out for us as well as the industry?
This custom synthesis project, unless the project goes into commercial phase, it is very difficult to project. That is the reason we have to do as many number of projects as possible to see success here. But we are doing good number of projects in the late stage clinical phase right now, for which we are building capacities, especially in hypotent. We are building a large scale capacity for NDA batches. And we also in the process of building large capacity for steroids and hormones as well. We cannot give a guidance on where this division will be in next 2 years, but we are very, very bullish on this division. That is the reason we have initiated construction of a dedicated CRAMS R&D with an investment of close to 150 crores with 2 lakh SFT R&D. And we acquired land for this division, and we are in the process of acquiring another piece of land for this division. That shows our confidence and conviction that this division will grow significantly in the near future.
Sure. And sir, with respect to the FDF, given that the debottlenecking is going to come this quarter and also the large capacity is coming in the second half, how do we see the, you know, traction to happen, sir? I mean, last time we were continuously surprised, you know, with the numbers that came in on the formulation side. So should we assume a quick, you know, say for the next 2 years, we should be able to completely utilize the capacity?
As and when the capacity is qualified and ready to go commercial, we have products to be made there. So the increased capacity, we have visibility that we will use pretty well, significantly. Yeah.
Yeah. And this triple combination, where do we see, sir? I mean, this market, you know, from the FDF side?
This triple combination, we do expect this year could be a $10 million opportunity for us in formulations, but next year could be big.
Okay.
Yeah. Out of $10 million, we have ordered for almost half of that. So we will service before September, and we do anticipate some additional orders for that. Whereas the big revenue is coming from the most popular triple combination drug, DLT, which we are servicing, and our supply commitment is very, very good, and our OTIF score, on time and full score, is also close to 100.
Sure. One final question from my side is, with the 1700 crores of capex that we are seeing, I think in various forums we have talked about, you know, somewhat aspiration of $1 billion sale, say, in the next couple of years. I mean, would this capex more or less suffice for us to take us to that, billion-dollar sales in the next couple of years, or should we do additional capex for this, sir?
Actually, the part of the capex which we will do in FY23 will not be used in FY23. So, I think to achieve that aspirational number, we don't need more capex. We don't need. I want to make it clear.
Thanks a lot, sir. That's largely something.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tushar Manudhane from Motilal Oswal Financial Services. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. So just on the Richcore side, now that acquisition is done and we have a clarity in terms of the new facility ramping up, so any color you would like to give, like how the revenue would shape up from this big facility?
The Richcore, the Laurus Bio new facility will go commercial in the next 2 weeks, actually by 15th of May.
Right.
And by September, entire facility will go commercial. We are putting 4 fermenters of 45,000 liters each. 2 fermenters will go commercial in the May, and 2 more fermenters will go commercial in the month of August, September. And we have order book for all those capacity. And we are also in discussion with current partners. And we are in the process of acquiring additional land. And we will create probably a 1 million liter fermentation capacity in the next growth.
Right. So for this existing four reactors, now that order book is in place, so the revenue visibility would also be there, I presume. So any number you would want to put to that in terms of sales potential?
We are not giving a number, but we hope we will double the revenue in the division, at least in FY22 itself.
Got it. And just lastly on this, so to create this 1 million capacity, 1 million liter capacity, incremental investment that 60 crore would be good enough, or would you need more?
The 60 crore is for the current 180,000 liter fermentation capacity. For 1 million liter, we are in the just drawing board stage, what could be the size of the fermenters and all. So maybe we will be able to provide you with a number in the next 6 months.
Got it. So this 1500 crore capex for 2 years, kind of that building the investment for this 1 million liter, right?
Partly considered. That is the reason we are giving a range between 1500 to 700 crore.
And just lastly on formulation, just a clarity out here, like, how has been the volume growth compared to the volume growth and the price growth for like last 3 quarters, where the revenue has been more or less stable?
Tushar, your question was not audible. Can you repeat your question?
On the formulation side, for the past 3 quarters, just would like to understand how has been the volume growth and the price growth in the FBF segment.
It's volume growth. So our revenues is coming from volume growth. We haven't increased any price for any of our APIs or formulations in FY21. It is only coming from volume growth and product expansion and volume growth.
Thanks. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Krish Mehta from Enam Holdings. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for taking my question and congratulations on the stellar numbers. I have 2 questions. The first one is, what is the percentage of non-ARV revenues for Q4 FY21 and for the entire year end of 21?
Non-ARV revenues are out of 1413 crores of total company's revenue, 570 crores came from ARV. About 40%. 60% is non-ARV revenue in Q4, Chris.
Okay. And what is the expectation for non-ARV revenues going forward for FY22?
FY22, we are not expecting major diversification of revenues. The FY22 revenue base will be very, very similar to FY21. But we do believe FY23, good diversification will happen. And we are working towards completely diversification of revenues by FY25. So that will be visible from FY23 onwards.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bharat Kumar from Quest for Value. Please go ahead.
Congratulations, Dr. Chava, on good set of numbers. My question is regarding custom synthesis. the current share of custom synthesis is around 10%. In an interview with the media a couple of months back, you said that 4 to 5 years down the line, the share of custom synthesis, which is very, very high margin business, would be around 20%. So it's almost double the share. So, and it means the growth in custom synthesis would outpace the growth in API and formulations. And already API and formulations for Laurus is growing at very, very high rate. So what I'm not clear is like, what makes you to be so bullish in custom synthesis segment to grow faster than API and formulations? Yeah, I understand that you already answered this question saying like you have some late stage molecules and all, but I mean, how many molecules and all, can you give some visibility on that?
We can't give you these details of what molecules, what phase and all, but we are very hopeful FY23 onwards, our custom synthesis growth will definitely outpace rest of the divisions.
Mm-hmm. So this would be from the Vizag manufacturing plant, is it?
Yes, that is the reason we are investing in capacities in this division. Once the capacities come commercial, I'm sure the growth in this division will be very good.
Yeah, got it. So once Vizag plant is commercial, then you have more growth in this custom synthesis, right?
Thanks. That's the your
okay. Answer. Yeah, and also you have a new R&D for this custom synthesis in Hyderabad. So that is mainly for the CRO services.
We are not doing any FTE service. To do CDMO. We don't do any FTE business. This is it's a dedicated site for CRAMS business.
Okay, got it. And my second question is regarding Laurus Bio. Where do you see Laurus Bio in 3 to 4 years from now? Like how much Laurus Bio would be contributing in terms of percentage to the top line 3 to 4 years from now?
It's a difficult question. Maybe right now the Laurus Bio FY21 is about 50 crore revenue. That is about 1.2% of revenue. Will it be 10% of revenue in 3 years? I doubt. But 50 crores become 200 crore, 300 crore probably yes. But that division's growth, we need to attract big customers, and we do expect we need another 4-5 years to make that division also very sizable. See, if you look at our CAMS division, was sizable, moderate right now, but it will become sizable in the next couple of years. But it took 7-8 years for us to nurture the division. So we will start putting our resources, our thoughts, our strategy, execution into the division. Will become sizable in the next 5 to 6 years.
Okay, got it. Yeah, thank you very much, sir. That's it. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Bharat.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please limit your questions to 2 per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, we would request you to rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Forum Parekh from Choice Broking. Please go ahead.
Hello. Thank you for taking my question and congratulations on a very good set of numbers. I just wanted to know, like, we have achieved the highest EBITDA margins ever. So, just wanted to know, like, can we sustain these kind of margins or, you know, should we assume that we have peaked out or going forward, the margins would be continued to come in from the product mix or from the cost rationalization? How should we assume, if you can throw some color on that?
As we are mentioning in the previous calls also, we are confident to maintain 30% EBITDA numbers for the FY22. From FY23 onwards, we do expect to maintain the same profit ratios.
Okay. And on the pricing side, we have not taken any price hike in FY21. So do we want to take any price hike in FY22?
See, our growth is not driven by price hikes. And I don't know why people think growing business by hiking prices. We want to grow business, make more money by increasing our product basket, increasing our market share. Our growth will be primarily driven by market share gain and portfolio enhancement, not by price hikes. We haven't done that in FY21. I do believe we will never do that in FY22 also. Yeah.
Okay, that's it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Parekh.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ranveer Singh from Sunidhi Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for taking my question. So my question is around ARV API. So this time the growth has been led by volume. What has been the growth in volume and price, if you could give some ballpark number?
This year, the significant revenue increase in ARV APIs came only because of volume gain. Earlier, we used to supply one or two APIs of the fixed dose combination, three-drug combination. In the most recent year, for the triple-drug combination, we got approvals for all the three APIs in the triple-drug combination. That's the reason our volume in ARV APIs went up significantly, which led to growth. And we do anticipate continue to have the same momentum in FY22 also. So we don't see that there is one off in our ARV APIs.
Yeah, sir. So just wanted to understand that macro scene. In ARV API, why this volume growth has suddenly been so high in this year? Is there any supplier from China or anybody has stopped supplying in API segment? Because I think the ARV market itself has not grown, especially during this COVID-related impact. So in this scenario, what actually has led this volume growth and whether this will sustain?
The one reason for volume growth, earlier the most preferred treatment was efavirenz based, where we don't have many approvals for lamivudine or tenofovir from many customers. When the therapy moved from efavirenz based to dolutegravir based, we got approvals for lamivudine and tenofovir with most of the customers. So people started buying three APIs, dolutegravir, lamivudine, tenofovir from us, where earlier people used to buy majority efavirenz and some tenofovir. So that's the primary reason for our volume growth last year.
Okay, so it's a preference of product for consumers. That is
yes.
And you said that in 23, diversification in API will see. So despite this diversification, our EBITDA margin would be the same or we see some negative or positive impact due to this diversification?
We don't see any dilution of margins because of diversification. So diversification means we have to look at there is a limited growth in ARV APIs right now. So we are already having a lion's share of market. So it is not easy to grow beyond. So we are adding diabetic segment, cardiovascular segment, which will be commercialized beginning last quarter FY22 onwards. So that's the reason we're investing more into non-ARV API infrastructure. Even our formulation also, most of the brownfield expansion what we're doing right now will be used for non-ARV.
Okay. And last one, can you give just broad breakup of CapEx 1500 to 1700 crore you mentioned? So how much of would be on FD and API and synthesis?
It is 50% is going into API intermediates, and then maybe 25% in FDF and 25% in custom synthesis. That's the broad breakup.
Okay, that's it from my side. Thank you
very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nimish Mehta from Research Delta Advisors. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and congrats on a great set of numbers. Just to continue from the previous participant, you mentioned that the growth in formulation has been driven by the shift in the product choice from effervescent based to dolutegravir based, DTG based. So how do you think, like, what is the scope of further growth in terms of this shift happening? And what is the competition outlook there? You know, I mean, are we likely to continue higher market share in the expanded market? That would be great for me to understand.
We will see some growth both in ARV APIs as well as formulations in FY22. But FY23 onwards, the growth will be driven by non-ARVs, both in APIs as well as in formulations. And from FY20 to FY21, the majority growth came from therapy shift from efavirenz based to dolutegravir based. Once that is done, and we do have the product basket, even there is a shift from one therapy to another therapy in ARVs, we are fully prepared to take that opportunity to our favor.
Correct. No, so what I am trying to understand is the shift towards dolutegravir based therapy has a kind of peak, in the sense like there is no more increase in DTG based therapy over efavirenz. Have we reached that point, or you still see that that is yet some far away, and you know, there is further scope of growth in that category, the DTG category, not just for Laurus, but in general, is the DTG category likely to grow?
Based on the reports, the DTG penetration will continue to increase in this year as well as next year.
Okay, the other thing I just wanted to know, in the API segment, I mean, we are a leader or like, you know, an expert in antiviral medication drugs. So are we not seeing any opportunity, you know, related to COVID drugs where, you know, the API was right from remdesivir to many of these protein inhibitors are now being touted as the potential drug for COVID, like, you know, new drugs like molnupiravir and all of those things. So do we not see an opportunity there, if maybe older drugs or new drugs, but COVID-related opportunity? And finally, if you can also let us know the opportunity related to Revlimid manufacturing of API. Thank you very much.
So, at the beginning of the COVID crisis, we produced the hydroxychloroquine sulfate, but it was never became popular. So we never had any significant sales coming out of that. Other than that, we haven't made any COVID-related APIs or formulations, and we are not planning to do that also.
For any particular reason, because that looks like to be one of the fastest, or you can correct me if my understanding is wrong. And I see Laurus as an expert in antiviral medications or drugs. So, like, you know, why not?
So, we are operating our capacities fully, and for us to divert these capacities for any opportunities, we have to miss our commitments to existing suppliers on ARVs. You know, ARVs is equally important for 20 million patients. So our commitment to supply ARVs on time, we honored in the COVID crisis. So we did that, but we were, I would say we didn't get an opportunity to serve. I put it that way. Yeah.
Okay. And finally, a word on the Revlimid, the API opportunity, now that Revlimid is likely to hit the US generic market next year. So, yeah. Your thoughts on that for us, you know, for a lot of people.
Nimish, we didn't get the name of the API you are talking about.
I'm talking about lenalidomide.
Molnupiravir?
Lenalidomide as API.
Lenalidomide, okay, you are talking about that. No, that's, we don't have any DMF in US. So we only we can't comment on that right now.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of T. Srihari from PCS Securities. Please go ahead. Mr. Srihari, your line is unmuted. Please go ahead with your question. There is no response from the line of the current participant. Ladies and gentlemen, please limit your questions to two per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, we would request you to rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Nitin Agarwal from DAM Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, so thanks for taking my question. Formulation business, in for FY21, what would be the typical composition of this business? How much would be LMIC business of this segment?
Nitin, the broad split is 3/4 in LMIC and 1/4 in Europe and North America. We do anticipate similar, actually 70-30 in FY22. And FY23 onwards, we do expect it will go to 2/3, 1/3. As we mentioned, the formulation diversification benefits will start showing in FY23 onwards. So FY23, we do expect 70-30. From 75-25, it will be 70-30. And FY23, that will be even bigger. So we will have maybe 60-40 in FY23.
But on the LMIC business market, do we see opportunities for further growth from where we are? How much further can this piece grow on from here?
So when we're saying the percentage is coming down, that doesn't mean the number is going down, Nitin. So we are increasing the other revenue significantly. That is the reason coming down. We do anticipate growth in LMIC market when compared to FY21 to 22. We see good growth in FY22. We do some growth in FY23 also. But the other non-ARV, non-LMIC business will grow significantly in FY23 based on the product what we filed, what we are going to file.
And doctor, on that point, on the non-LMIC business, what proportion of this, so this is what largely going to be developed market business, US and Canada, European business that will drive it, or what will drive the non-LMIC business for us from 23 onwards?
Non-LMIC business is only from Europe and North America, nothing else for us.
So that is based on the visibility of the ANDA. This is all the product that we do in our own, under our own ANDA or our own filing.
Yeah, the fully integrated offerings.
And then where do we capture the contract manufacturing for formulations, or is there a business like that?
There are three types of contract manufacturing we're doing. Contract manufacturing, generic APIs will come in generic APIs itself. We do contract manufacturing of formulations, generic formulations that comes in formulations division. The contract manufacturing clinical programs, it comes in synthesis division.
And so how big is this contract manufacturing for formulations in the formulation business?
Most of our European sale is, as of now, is contract manufacturing.
Okay. Thank you, doctor.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tushar Bora from MK Ventures. Please go ahead.
Morning. Thank you for the opportunity and congratulations to management for a very good set of numbers. Sir, I wanted to understand, when we discuss custom synthesis, are we including the specific opportunities on cosmeceuticals and nutraceuticals within that? If you can just help understand if there are any, significant triggers in this part of the business. That's one. And second, I wanted to understand, are there any vaccine-related opportunities, like as an adjuvant or, any such opportunities for Laurus going forward that we are exploring?
I'll answer the first question. Whatever the nutraceuticals, dietary supplements we sell to multiple customers is not part of the synthesis business. any product we make exclusive to one customer will be part of the synthesis business. We are putting those one customer exclusive products will be in synthesis business. When we sell to multiple customers, that is not part of that. The second question, are we making anything for vaccine business? Our bio division makes cell culture ingredients which are used in the vaccine manufacturing. We are not making adjuvants right now.
Okay, so but is there a COVID related vaccine play also then for our bio division? If not now, in future, are we exploring?
I don't think we will be catching the COVID vaccine wave by supplying ingredients from bio division. I don't think that will be an opportunity for us.
Sure. Sir, second, we mentioned the sterile facility. You know, we're setting up a plant specifically for steriles and hormones. In previous call, we had mentioned the possibility of an M&A in this space. So, does this investment preclude that in that M&A activity, or is that something we are also looking at in parallel?
I didn't remember we mentioned M&A activities, steroids and hormones. Our investments into steroids and hormones is based on the our discussions with the potential customer and the volumes what we are talking. So we need a specific exclusive capacity for steroids and hormones. So we are investing based on our discussions what we are doing with the potential customer.
Okay, sure, sir. And just one last on the overall capacity constraints that we've been facing and, you know, the continuous upward revision in CAPEX. Have we also looked at you know, why haven't we looked at, say, acquiring plants, US FDA, you know, designated plants? I'm sure that there would be a few available. Have we explored that route to augment capacity faster?
We looked at earlier, but we believe building our own capacity is much more cost-effective. See, no capacity will come at 1x of sales. So, whereas our asset turnover ratio is 1.5 right now. So, we believe putting capex, greenfield or brownfield, to enhance capacity is much more cost-effective than acquisition.
Sure, sir. And a clarification on one of the points you mentioned in the call. So this 1500 to 1700 capex over FY22-23 is not likely to be contributing, or at least the FY23 portion is not going to contribute to your 1 billion revenue target. That's the point you mentioned, right?
Part of it will not be required to go to the target. Yeah, what we do in FY23 will not be fully utilized in FY23 itself.
Okay. Fair enough, sir. Thank you very much. I'll join back in the chat.
Thank you, Tushar.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankush Agarwal, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for taking my question, sir. Just one question. We have been having a stand that ARV as a business will not grow much for us, given that we're already a big player in the market. So for Laurus to grow at a high rate, our other business of non-ARV and businesses has very faster pace, because non-ARV business is still relatively small for us, like around 25-30%. So what are the initiatives and objectives that you're targeting over the next couple of years for this business to grow that fast, if you can highlight this?
There's two things. Non-ARV, API and formulation growth, we already developed the products. We have filed DMFs. We have filed dossiers for marketing authorizations. That is already, I would say, midway in that diversification. When it comes to the custom synthesis investments, what we are doing, half of it based on some kind of a commitment what we are having from our customers with respect to capacity. And the rest is to increase the product portfolio and custom synthesis. See, not every product will go to commercial when we do phase one. So we wanted to increase our phase one pipeline. Right now we are constrained to take more phase one projects. That is the reason we are creating a dedicated capacity. Right now, when there is a project, allocation of resources is becoming a challenge, both in R&D or in manufacturing. We wanted to take away that constraint and bring some abundancy. We are creating 2 lakh SFT R&D for CRAMS, and we are creating 2 new sites for CRAMS division. So by FS23, CRAMS division will have 3 manufacturing sites, hopefully 4, and an R&D center. So that will be a fairly big organization itself.
Okay, got it. And secondly, on the FDF business, the entire growth we are targeting for next couple of years is on the contract manufacturing opportunity with the European customers, wherein they are adding more products, right?
No. Majority growth will come from non-contract manufacturing.
Okay, so this is apart from the opportunity that we will have based on the European customer with the added capacity that we are adding.
We'll grow contract manufacturing, but the non-contract manufacturing revenues and formulations also will be significant.
Oh, okay. Okay. Thank you. That would be awesome. Much.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Onkar Gugardare from Shri Consultancy. Please go ahead.
Yeah, based on the CapEx number you talked about for the next 2 years, what kind of asset turn you are expecting on that?
You can give a broad number, Bankav. It is about 1.5, what we have achieved right now. Yeah, you can expect that.
Okay, and what would be the maximum revenue potential in that, expecting 100% capacity utilization?
You do a math to see 1500 into 1.4, 1.5, that could be the opportunity. But see, we continue to invest. See, if we stop investing, how will we grow? So, see, for this investment, we are not raising debt. Probably everything will be done through internal accruals. We also need to be careful in when our ROCE and return on equity numbers are so high and our cost of debt is so low. So the question and our challenge for us is to go for CapEx, which is giving very high good returns, versus retiring our debt. See, our debt by EBITDA is less than 1.9, little over 0.9. So we are doing that constant debate internally, whether to retire debt or to put more CapEx. So see, we are very cautious in putting CapEx. See, why we will do recklessly CapEx? We are doing CapEx because we have seen visibility and then customers are asking for it. We know what to make. We know whom to sell. And because of those comforts, we are investing in CapEx.
Okay, so the second question is, you have been selling stake in the open market to reduce the edge which you have done. So what would be the plan on that front?
Well, there is no pledge of shares from my side. Everything was removed.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Gagan Thareja from Kotak. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Sir, your voice is not audible, sir.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Sir, just wanted to clarify, there will not be any additional debt for the CAPEX that you're undertaking next 2 years?
Gagan, it is not very audible.
There may not be any significant debt increase.
Okay.
Yep.
And also, there will be probably a fixed cost increase as the CAPEX comes in. If you could give some idea of the OPEX depreciation, you know, which will come in because of the additional capacity?
Can you repeat your question? Your question is not very clear. Your voice is not very clear.
So my question is that with the additional capex, there will be additional opex and depreciation also coming in. So what could be the magnitude of opex and depreciation for related to the additional capacity?
The most of it is a brownfield. It is in proportionate to the capex and the operations utilization.
I'll answer, Gagan, to your question. In FY 18-19, we have created so many greenfield facilities had an impact on our OPEX depreciation in our PAT numbers. But this time, most of the expansion is happening in the brownfield, and we don't see the investment impacting our numbers from now onwards.
Okay. And for your LMIC formulations piece, I think this year all the sales would have been from the TLD combination. You also have the approval for TLE 400, where you'd probably be, from a competitive standpoint, it's probably a better market, although probably of a lower size. If you could give some idea of what could be the size for the TLE 400 market going into next year?
We can give you the TLE 400 usage in general. We will not give you what market share we have. It is between $120 to $150 million TLE 400 opportunity.
Okay. Yes. Okay. And TLE 600?
TLE 600, the opportunity is very small. Very small.
Okay. Okay. But TLE 400, the number of approved companies would be only 2 to 3 at most?
Yeah, 3 as of now.
Okay. And you also indicated you have the approval for TAF-based formulations, if I understood it correctly, or is it for the API you're talking of?
We got approval for dolutegravir amphotericin TAF NDA, and we also got orders. We also got orders for these formulations, and we will service that in the next 6 months. And we do expect more orders for that.
Okay. On TAF, just wanted your expert opinion. What I am able to understand is that because of TAF, the weight gain, especially in the female cohort of the African population, is very high. North of 10 kg, and that's a concern for comorbidity. Do you concur with that, and therefore do you see that being a limited sort of market right now, or do you see this as a product that will substitute TDF in a very big way?
See, the difference between switch from efavirenz to dolutegravir is a class. So efavirenz is a NNRTI and dolutegravir is integrase inhibitor. When it comes to tenofovir and TAF, it's the same class. So we don't see the disruption like efavirenz to tenofovir, efavirenz to dolutegravir, similar to TDF and TAF. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. That's all from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tarang from Old Bridge Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon. So, just was reconciling some numbers. Laurus today would have a gross block of about 2,600 crores, and there's about a CWIP of 400 crores, so that's 3,000 crores, and about 1,500 crores of capex going in the next 2 years, part of which will not help in the revenue in FY23. So if I add all of this up, about 4,000 crores of gross block, so 1.5x would translate about 6,200 crores of revenue. Whereas you've been indicating that maybe this asset base could help us reach about $1 billion of revenue. So where is the disconnect, sir?
You are talking about net block, probably. No, our gross block could be bigger than 4,000 crores. If you take 1,500 additional capex, it will be maybe close to 5,000 crore gross block.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's the math, 5,000 crores of gross block and 1.5x.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. The last question is from the line of Prashant Rane from Exclusive Advisors. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity and congratulations for that set of numbers. My question is about what we are expanding our businesses in so many new areas, and there are a lot of challenges which will be going ahead. So how it works out in terms of management bandwidth and attracting talent? I saw the ESOP plan. So I would like to know the management views about it. And do you think this ESOP is one of the dilution, or it is going to be a feature for attracting talent? Thank you.
Thanks for asking a very interesting question, Prashant. We continuously allocate stock options to attract, retain talent. And we are setting a benchmark in the pharma industry with the number of stock options and the value of the stock options, what we have given to our colleagues. Right now, we are not seeing any challenge in attracting talent in any of these divisions. And we constantly look out for adding mid to senior management talent in all the divisions. And we continue to add that. See, one good thing is we are not in the process of adding hundreds of handas. We are not having the strategy of filing hundreds of DMMs. So our approach is develop few products, maximize those products into many geographies and get leadership position and gain market share. So with that, our commitment to scale, commitment to quality is very well appreciated across the industry. And that is helping us to retain talent very well.
And is that the revenue per employee, is that the metric which you track internally?
Pardon, Prashant?
So revenues per employee, is that the metric which you track internally? And if you can also answer about the management bandwidth going ahead, is it sufficient or you expect some organization changes?
We do monitor revenue per employee, EBITDA per employee since inception. And currently our revenue per employee is little over a crore per employee. And when it comes to the bank, which if you look at our Richcore acquisition, we didn't acquire a company, we acquired the talent. In fact, the current leadership team and the founders will continue to run. So there, we don't see any bandwidth, management bandwidth challenge. When it comes to the other business, we are running the same business, adding more blocks, more products. So we are adding talent, and currently we don't see any challenge in senior management bandwidth right now.
Yeah. Thank you, and all the best.
Thank you, Prashant.
Thank you. I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Thank you, Nikhil, for organizing this call, and thank you for all of you for participating and giving us your perspective how we should perform and how we should invest. And thank you, and keep safe during this pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of Ambit Capital Private Limited, this concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.